I've just found joy. I'm as happy as a baby boy with another brand new choo-choo toy. When I met my sweet Lorraine, 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 she's got a pair of eyes that are brighter than the summer skies. When you see them, you'll realize why I love my sweet Lorraine.
Welcome to Jazz for Curious Readers, one of the many presentations of the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. My name is Lauren Schoenberg. I'm the senior scholar at the museum, and today we will be talking to author Will Friedwald, whose new biography of Nat Cole, Straighten Up and Fly Right, is a major addition to American musical literature and cultural literature as well. Will Friedwald has been published in the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, The Village Voice, Newsday, The New York Observer, The New York Sun, Entertainment Weekly. Plus, he's written some of the most wonderful books on American vernacular music. His specialty is the era of the Great American Popular Songbook. Sinatra, The Song as You, is, for my money, the best musical examination of Frank Sinatra's life. It's almost like a biography through music. He's also written the biographical guide to the great jazz and pop singers, Jazz Singing, America's Greatest Voices, and Stardust Melodies, the biography of 12 of America's most popular songs. But it's Nat Cole that we're going to talk about today. I think you'll find it fascinating. I know I did. Well, it's great to see you. And we're going to be talking today about this specific book of yours. You've written so many others, and I'd like to actually talk about some of them at the end of the interview. But this book, the Nat Cole book, you have been, one of the leading scholars and writers and thinkers about Nat Cole for a long time. So I guess I'll start with two questions. First of all, when did you originally encounter Nat Cole's music? What were the circumstances and how did it strike you? And then B would be, talk about the genesis of this major biography.
You know, I do think I have an interesting perspective in that I would say probably, of course, since Nat left us in 1965, most people encounter him first as a singer. And then if they're into jazz, they gradually discover that before he was a singer, he was the greatest, you know, one of the greatest jazz piano players ever. And that's the usual progression. But because my circumstances are kind of special, I think. You knew my dad, and he was a huge, huge jazz guy. And I was probably listening to the Nat King Cole, Lester Young records even as I was first listening to Unforgettable and Mona Lisa and Nature Boy. So from the beginning of my knowledge of Nat, I knew him in both roles, which I think is rather unique. Like I say, because most people, I mean, of course, in Nat's generation, most people knew him as a piano player. And then, you know, his old friends were somewhat surprised that he became a singer, not just a singer, but, you know, the one of the two or three greatest pop singers ever. So that was the experience of people in Nat's lifetime. And the people since who've discovered him mainly know him as a singer, and they might be surprised to discover what a great piano player he was. But me, from the first time I was aware of him at all, it was in both roles. And if you remember the world before CDs, before the internet, before Mosaic Records even, one of the odd things about Nat's development was that everything he did was so successful that it pushed away whatever came before. So when he became the leader of a trio, people forgot that he had ever had a big band. When he first started doing all these ballads, people forgot that he did other kinds of things. When he first started to add strings, people forgot about the trio. When he did this, then when he did the country songs and the Latin songs and the stuff he did in the 60s, everybody forgot about everything else. And that's, you know, sort of the way Nat set it up. He was just so successful in everything he did. And he himself did not encourage people, you know, he only lived to be 45, but he did not ever want to think about the past. He never, when people talk about the trio, he would say, oh, that's just something I did years ago. He did not remember his own past. That was not his thing. And I just think that, and if you remember that early period, like I said, when you were interested in Nat Cole in the 50, in the 80s, the only thing you could get were maybe the greatest hits and some of the albums, but it was almost impossible to find anything by the trio. John Pizzarelli talks about a little bit about that in the intro to the book, how if you were interested in that. And then I remember there was a three, when I worked at Tower Records, and this is already 1985, there was a three LP French set of the King Cole trio that had, it was at that time an LP was 36, it was 12 tracks. So three LPs was 36 tracks by the trio. And it was like, I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe I could actually listen to 36 old tracks by the trio. Of course, now, you know, when you listen to the entire world by just clicking on Spotify or Apple Music, it's a whole different universe. But to gradually, and then when the, of course, I had the opportunity about 5 years after that in the early 90s to work on the Mosaic King Cole Trio box. And of course, the 90s was the King Cole Renaissance, both in terms of the trio and in terms of what Natalie did when she did the duet on Unforgettable. That was a huge hit. People forget that wasn't just old folks who were buying that record. That was a huge, huge record. You heard Unforgettable everywhere. And there was a tremendous Nat King Cole revival 25 to 30 years after he died. And I was in the middle of that. And I was, by that point, I had been working in the Sinatra book, and I was equally interested in Nat King Cole. And I was interviewing, you know, all the, because they both worked at Capitol Records, they had the same musical directors, Nelson Riddle, Billy May, Gordon Jenkins. A lot of the people I talked to about Sinatra also were people to talk about Nat King Cole. So I was interested in doing a book on that, you know, for about 30 years, at least 30 years ago. And I finally did it now. I finally got around to doing it now. But I was always interested I was always looking towards doing a book on that from, you know, the very beginning of the time I got interested in music. Well, that's a long answer to a short question.
That's good. Now, the second part of the question was, what is the genesis of this biography happening now? How did the gears move?
Well, I will tell you, for years, I was working with this great editor, Bob Gottlieb, who's way more famous than I am. And not that I'm any kind of metric of fame, but Bob always was pushing me to look at the biggest picture possible. And I kept saying, well, I really want to do this book on that. And Bob was like, he and I worked together on this huge book on songs. Then we did a huge book on singers, which was the biggest book of all. It was almost a million words. Then we did this huge book on albums. And that's kind of the way Bob was. He's still very much with us. He's very much a big picture guy. And I kept bringing up the Nat book, and I couldn't sell him on it. You know, this is what writers go through with their editors. So Bob is, I think it's fair to say he's semi-retired. He will be 90, he's 89 right now. You're allowed to be semi-retired at 89. And he'll be 90 in next year, in 2021. And so this was the first book I did without Bob in about 25 years. And I brought it to Oxford, and they liked it immediately. So we just got going. And I was hoping to get it out by, for so many reasons, I wish I could have gotten it out. I wish I had started it a year or two earlier and gotten it out a year or two earlier. It would have been so much better to have it out in 2019. Not only because that was the centennial, and they were saying, oh, what does it make? You know, what difference does it make, you know, if it's a few months after the centennial? Well, nobody knew in 2019 that the pandemic was coming, and opportunities to promote a book would be severely limited. So that's another reason, of course, you know, looking back in hindsight, why I wish we had the book out a year earlier. But because I've done no in-store book events, and even though these Zooms are great and I'm enjoying this, it's not the same as doing an in-store where you can actually sell books on the premises. You know, that really, as you know, with your own experience as an author, when you do an in-store, that really is very specific to sales.
Sure.
In person, in at point in person, or whatever the expression
okay.
is.
Okay. How would you tell his life story if you had 5 or 10 minutes?
Well, I would start with one point, which is the perception of Nat, and this is to a degree stage managed by Nat himself, was whenever people would ask him, which is the standard question in celebrity journalism, you know, up until contemporary times, I guess now the standard question is, who do you sleep with? But the standard question they would ask almost every successful celebrity throughout the 20th century was, to what do you account for your great success? And Nat had to come up with an answer for that. He didn't want to say, well, because I'm talented, I know what I'm doing. That was the answer. But he would say was, as kind of a way of kind of sloughing it off, he was born on March 17th, 1919. And he would say, well, I was born on St. Patrick's Day, and I owe everything to the luck of the Irish. And people would joke, because here's an African-American pretending to be Irish or making an allusion to the Irish. It was an obvious sort of, you know, disconnect there. You know, most Black people didn't say things like that. And very few Irish people even said things like that. So it was a joke. He made a joke out of it. And he would say that, you know, I was born on St. Patrick's Day. And later on, of course, he named the three of his, he deliberately gave most of his kids Irish names, you know, sort of courting that news. And he said that he carried a shillelagh in his pocket. Well, the truth is, Nat was not only extraordinarily talented, but he, like Sinatra, he had a clear vision of what he wanted to do. And he said in one interview, when I first started playing the piano, I knew I had to be a leader. And to me, that's really interesting. Most people that entered the music business in the 30s, especially if they were musicians rather than singers, even if they were singers, they would get a job as a sideman. If, you know, you were a piano player, you found a band where the leader was not a piano player, and, you know, you got a job in that band. And you worked your way up if you wanted to be a band leader, you know, step by step. And Nat didn't take that path. Nat wanted to be a band leader and a piano player. And as I talk about in the book, and as you know, it's no secret, his original role model was Earl Father Hines, who was by far the piano king, one of the first great piano players in jazz, and the piano king of Chicago in the 1920s when Nat was a kid. And he deliberately modeled himself after Earl Father Hines. He started his own dance band in which he wrote most of the songs and wrote all the arrangements. He really was a dedicated band leader, and Duke Ellington was his role model as well, especially in terms of band leading and how to comport yourself as a musician. And but like I say, he always knew what he was doing, and he was always keen to experiment, to try something new. And that's why he would always say that everything that happened to me is an accident, a lucky accident, the luck of the Irish. And when he gradually made the shift from leading a 12-piece big band to leading the King Cole Trio, he said it was just an accident. In other words, they were in a small space where the big band wouldn't fit, and he originally hired a drummer, but the drummer didn't show up. I parsed all these things in the book, but the larger truth is when he started working with just piano, bass, and guitar, he liked the sound, and the public responded to it. And everything he did was like that. He would try something. He would try a dozen ideas and see what worked. And that's why he gradually added singing. And he gave the same sort of a story. Oh, I just started singing because it was an accident. I just, you know, somebody in, you know, a drunk wouldn't shut up until I sang Sweet Lorraine. So I sang Sweet Lorraine and people liked it. So I kept doing it. And, you know, and there may be some truth to that. But the point is, he was always willing to experiment. And I think even more than Sinatra, even more than some of his other role models, he was always willing to try something new, from shifting from leading the band to the trio, to singing, and then to singing popular songs, and then to singing with, you know, orchestras. And then, you know, at the end of his life, when he was trying, he made three albums where he sings in Spanish, and then he made three albums where he sings country songs. He was always willing to try something new, and he probably had two or three ideas that didn't work for every one that did. And that's, I think, you know, how he made this progression from being certainly, I think we can agree, one of the top 10, maybe even top 5 jazz piano players of all time, or certainly of his time, to the most popular singer of his time. And by the time he reached his pinnacle as a vocalist, say in the mid 50s, the three major male singers who were always on the charts at any given time in the pre-Elvis era were Frank Sinatra, Perry Como, and Nat Cole. And when you look at the statistics, when you know, crunch the numbers, Nat Cole was always ahead. Nat Cole, by that point, The mid to late 1950s, he was selling more records than anybody. He was the, not only was he the most famous African-American in the world, he was the Mr. Pop Music. He was the number one charted, biggest selling singer, in the known universe at that point, not just in America, but internationally. He always made a point to make records. He specialized in foreign songs for a while. He did a lot of songs from England, from Europe, from France, and was hugely, like I say, the most popular figure in the music world, for a period in the mid 1950s, which was an astonishing achievement for an African American at that point. I mean, when he came up, there's an interview with Billy Eckstine where he talks about how black men were not encouraged to sing love songs. I mean, how are you not going to be popular if you don't sing love songs? And Nat and Eckstine both broke that taboo. You know, he just came. When you look at where he started and where he wound up, it's just an amazing life and an amazing accomplishment. And it's a tragic life because he died of cancer at age 45, and he managed to accomplish, all this before he was 45. And that probably is longer than 10 minutes. So
that's fascinating. No, it's true, because what? Frank Sinatra would have been 45 in what? In 1960? Uh-huh. I guess, right? So, if you just imagine that Sinatra's career ended in 1960, before everything that happened, before My Way and all that.
Yeah, I know. Before that whole third act of his career,
Right, so what the potential could have been there. Got so many fascinating things that you mentioned, and in life and in as a book as complete as Will's is. Now, at the same time that he's selling more records than anyone in the world and all this kind of stuff, there's this debacle of the television show. And it seems almost impossible to reconcile these two things unless you were alive in that. Well, I mean, it's not impossible, just part of racism in America. But how can we juxtapose the guy who's selling the most records, more than Frank Sinatra and Perry Como all around the world? And on the other hand, he tries to get on network television and this famous debacle happens.
When we at that point, for one thing, TV was coming in as the new thing, but TV in the 1950s was still not as big as other things. TV was still it was still kind of a niche-y thing, even probably up until the early 60s. And I think that, even the racism aside, record sales don't always guarantee successful television, even, into the MTV era. Maybe that's a whole other thing. So that's one way to look at it. And the other way is this business model that the television industry was using, which was a holdover from radio, and which is one that producers were trying to break even then, which is that the advertising agencies controlled, owned, ran everything, and the networks were kind of very, very subservient to the advertisers and the advertising agencies. So it's kind of a business model problem. And by the 60s, they fixed it. In fact, one of the things that the quiz show scandal did, one of the helpful fallouts from the quiz show scandal, was that it helped break what they called the stranglehold by the sponsors and the advertising agencies on television.
And I do understand. Well,
okay. I'm getting a little too specific and technical.
No.
The idea was that one, the major variety shows, and name those, which were hosted by.
I want to interrupt.
Sure.
I'm sorry.
I'm getting too deep in the weeds. Yes.
No. It's excellent, but it's more specialized than I think.
Right.
Than what I need here. What I was hoping you could do now that we understand that, and frankly, some of that is new to me. I didn't understand the relationship between the network and the advertisers. But can you tell, for people who are watching this interview who actually don't know what happened with Nat Cole,
right,
with television, yes, can you tell that story simply? You know what I mean.
At this point, the major variety shows, including Ed Sullivan, Perry Como, Dinah Shore, had one big sponsor. So when Nat Cole gets a chance to host his own variety show, they're looking for this one big sponsor. And at this point, even though, and two things you should be aware of, A, he's the most popular singer by far in the country, and his records are selling tremendously. And this is a good moment for singers on TV like Perry Como and Dinah Shore, and even Sinatra tried a series in 1957, around the same time. They were going with this one advertiser model. And the problem was that no advertiser wanted to associate with an African-American spokesman. And that's what I haven't said up until now. And there was no way to make the show a success. And at the same time, like I say, Nat was not only the most biggest selling recording star, he was the most popular entertainer in Las Vegas. And he could make $50,000 a week in Las Vegas. And he had an exclusive contract with the Sands, where Frank Sinatra had equity. Frank Sinatra was a part owner of the Sands, and yet Nat Cole was making more money at the Sands than even Sinatra. So he was hugely popular, but at the Sands, they didn't seem to even mind that he was black, and I hate to put it like that, but at the Sands, Sinatra and others had made the point to allow black entertainers to stay there, even in a moment when this is technically illegal, because of segregation laws. But to get that to translate to television, they would have to find a sponsor, and no sponsor wanted to identify with an African-American product and with an African-American entertainer. And this was the first. There had been a couple of smaller shows. There's one with Hazel Scott. There's one with Billy Daniels. But this is the first time a black star hosted a major network variety show, and no sponsor wanted to have their product endorsed.
I understand.
This is the fact of racism in the USA, 1956 and 1957.
Right.
And that was incredibly bitter about it. And it was just about the first time, if you read all the interviews with Nat, unlike Sinatra, unlike Ella Fitzgerald, Nat frequently gave interviews, but you can't always trust what he's saying. And I don't mean you can't trust it, but when Nat gives an interview, he's always speaking to his agenda at the moment. You know, he's telling you what he wants what he wants things to be and what he wants you to think. He's not necessarily, you know, venting the way he feels about being a black man in this time, you know, going through this. He almost never talks about this. But finally, in 1957, when this is happening, he finally comes out and says, you know, this is ridiculous. You know, I'm selling all these records. Why doesn't, you know, some advertise? He says, why doesn't the phone company sponsor me? Are people going to so object to seeing a black man sing on television that they're going to say, take my phone out? I don't want to have a phone if they're going to be sponsored by, if they're going to be involved with a black guy. You know what I'm saying?
And this is the same year, you know, that we have Armstrong and a Little Rock thing. So it really does seem like there's a groundswell. If we can back up just for a moment.
Yes.
On the same topic, can you tell us the story of Benny Carter and Nat Cole and living in Los Angeles and the neighborhoods?
Well, the one of the fascinating things I found out in this book, the whole world, well, okay, it's been part of the record that in 1948, Nat got married for the second time, bought a house. He and his wife bought a house in an all-white neighborhood. And then the neighbors tried to get rid of them because, you know, they claimed it was a segregated neighborhood. And there was a tremendous brouhaha. And Nat, and even Maria, till the end of her life, tended to downplay it. They said, oh, you know, those neighbors, they were up in arms at first, but, you know, we got over it. We patched things up. Well, I don't know why Maria would tend to downplay it, but if you look at the circumstances at the time, it was pretty vicious. They poisoned Nat's dog. It's been reported, I do not think it's true, it's been reported that the Klan burned a cross on Nat's lawn. I don't think that actually happened, but they did, some neighbors burned the N-word. I don't know how they did it. They had some incredibly creative horticultural racists who were able to burn the N-word on his lawn. And Nat's daughters remembered that even when it grew out, they could still see the vague impression of the N-word for like 10 years later, right on the lawn. And that's known. And it's also known that they took a shot through his window. Somebody actually fired a bullet through his window while Nat was on the road. And it could be argued that they knew. I mean, Nat's whereabouts were not a secret. You know, you could read the paper and find out where he was. And they deliberately picked a night where he was not home to fire a shot through his window. But still, firing a shot through his window, you know, still a pretty brutal
action. The wife and kids are there.
I think they might have tried to pick a night when nobody was home. I knew the kids weren't born yet. This was right after he moved in. The kids weren't there yet, and Maria was with him. I mean, I don't want to argue in their behalf. Yeah.
No, I understand. Wasn't Benny Carter also involved with Nat? With that stuff?
I don't know of any direct connection between Nat and that. But Benny also moved into a house in a neighborhood, right?
Right, right, right.
But one of the things I found out in this book, which is very interesting, and it's again a case of Nat not actually, I mean, you know, he's not, unlike, say, Sammy Davis and Louis were probably the most extreme, in that Louis Armstrong would always tell you what was exactly on his mind with very, I mean, he would be cheerful about it, but if he was angry, he would tell you he was angry. And that's another great thing. I envy a scholar like Ricky Riccardi, because when Louis Armstrong says something, he generally means it, whereas Nat tends to put, you know, a face on things. And Nat would never admit it, but it turns out, I know that he was well aware that in early 1948, there was a decision by the Supreme Court, Shelley versus Kramer, which made housing covenants illegal. In other words, you could not claim, unconstitutional, you could not legally exclude somebody from buying a house any place in America on the basis of race or religion. It was not as far-reaching as the Civil Rights Act of 1964, but Nat knew he was legally within his constitutional rights to buy that house. And he never mentioned that, but I one thing I found out was 2 years earlier, I think it was around 1946, he bought a house. He had previously bought another house in another white neighborhood, and that wound up going to his first wife, and he never actually lived there. But everything, the more I researched Nat and the more you look at all the facts as they come up, Nat knew exactly what he was doing. And it's my belief that he deliberately bought that house with his wife Maria as a statement, as you know, a point of racial pride, that he was going to deliberately desegregate this neighborhood. It wasn't just, at the time he acted like, oh, I just bought the house because I wanted, but no, I really think he knew exactly what he was doing, and it was a very specific act on his part in terms of integration.
I'd like to jump now to a totally different topic, which are two great figures who really seem to be disciples of Nat Cole's. I'm wondering if you could talk about artistically, personally, how they related to his example. Ray Charles and Johnny Mathis. It is impossible to contemplate either one without, you know, the Nat Cole influence. They've turned it into something totally different.
Well,
could you talk about Mathis
and
Charles?
I'll give you an even bigger picture answer. The older I get and the more I study, the more I think about jazz and the Great American Songbook and American music, it really occurs to me that in terms of the way the songbook, the Great American Songbook, and songs in general, even beyond the Great American Songbook, the way that music is sung really comes down to three people: Frank Sinatra, Ella Fitzgerald, and Nat King Cole. And Nat had the hugest possible influence, especially, and not just the people that sang, you know, Stardust and Mona Lisa and you know, the great, you know, American Songbook, but on soul singers, on rhythm and blues singers, on black music in general, up until this very, even on spiritual and gospel singers, up until this very day. And as Ray Charles himself said, you know, Ray Charles always talked about how when he was first starting, the only way you could get a job playing in any black neighborhood was to start a trio and sing like Nat King Cole. That's what the bars were hiring in every black neighborhood across the country. And other people have looked at that and said that the two guys who were most extremely popular in, you know, rhythm and blues and black music at this point were Nat King Cole and Louis Jordan. And every town had one guy who had a timpani five type band like Louis Jordan and another guy who had a trio and sang ballads and novelties like Nat King Cole. And Ray Charles, you know, has talked about how much he idolized Nat Cole and was very happy to be, you know, a Nat King Cole disciple for that first part of his career. And if you listen to the early recordings, you know, that's just what he sounds like up until the point in the mid-1950s when he gets the octet and starts getting more into what people would later call soul music and like that. But even when Ray Charles sings Georgia on My Mind, I can hear Nat King Cole in that, you know.
And also, but I mean, you mentioned before, you know, that Nat did country western.
Exactly.
And did he do it before Ray Charles?
I haven't looked at it month by month, but those two albums, Rambling Rose and Modern Sounds and Country Music, were almost simultaneous. I mean, Ray Charles loved country music from the very beginning too, so he may not have picked that up from that. But yeah, at the same time, the two of them went into country music almost simultaneously. Sure. And Mathis has, of course, it's funny, I was once doing an interview with Mitch Miller, and he was saying, oh, I think of everything I've done, I'm most proud of having worked with Tony Bennett. And then Mitch would say, well, I'm also, he kind of corrected himself, I'm also very proud of, you know, everything I did with Johnny Mathis. And then he said, but when you think about it, Mathis really was sort of, you know, a Nat King Cole clone, whereas Tony was much more of an original, which I thought was an interesting way to put it. Now, I wouldn't say Mathis was a Nat King Cole clone, but you listen to that voice, you listen to that ethereal sound, the production, definitely he comes, you know, and Mathis, of course, gladly admits that he was a huge Nat King Cole fan and that Nat was a huge inspiration. I think it's fair to say with the two of them, as Dizzy once said about Louis Armstrong, no him, no me, no Nat Cole, we really wouldn't have Ray Charles, we really wouldn't have Johnny Mathis. And I think if they were both here, they would both go along with that.
Nat, Will, are there any artists in 2020, I mean, you know, John Pizzarelli, of course, and his trio, and people who are within the jazz world and the pop world, are there any quote unquote contemporary artists in the last decade or two who are dealing with contemporary trends in pop music who have talked about Nat Cole or in whom you can hear things or?
Well, from the 90s and up until today, Diana Krall, of course, and John Pizzarelli, but even younger and even more contemporary, of course, Gregory Porter did that beautiful album of Nat King, the Nat King Cole Songbook. I think that's one of my favorite albums of the millennium. It's a new millennium, but it's a beautiful, beautiful album. I like Sashel Vasandani. He definitely has a Nat King Cole kind of a sound. Alan Harris, contemporary jazz singer, is a huge Nat Cole disciple. And I know you're familiar with Voyo Satoshi, and I'm probably not pronouncing it right, but boy, without even trying to, he can do an incredible Nat King Cole sound. I hate to describe George Benson as an older musician. Oh my God, I guess we're all older. I never thought the day would come when George Benson was an older musician, but he did a beautiful Nat King Cole album a few years ago. And he almost sounds more like, when he sings, he can sound more like Nat than almost anybody. It's almost scary how much he sounds like Nat. But yeah, I would say between all these guys, the Nat King Cole influence is huge today. One thing, I mean, when I hear young singers, everybody says, oh, I want to do an After Midnight album. It's funny because Nat did that album and it was a success and he was happy with it, but his career had about 7 or 8 more years to go. And I wish he had done another album like that, but no, he was satisfied with that. And, you know, even I remember Vic Damone, in the last few years of his life, he was saying, I want to do an After Midnight type album.
Let me interject here just for a moment for folks listening who may not know what the After Midnight album is, but it was Nat Cole in 1956, I think it was, and he brought back some of his old friends from when he was doing more jazz work, you know, Harry Sweet Cedison, Juan Teasel, Stuff Smith, and Willie, and a few others with his trio with Lester Young's brother on drums. And it was kind of like a late night jam session. And if you don't know that record, it's certainly one of the things that you should definitely listen to if you'd like to hear more about Nat Cole. You mentioned sounding unbelievably like Nat Cole. Can you tell us a little bit about his piano playing brothers?
Oh, you mean
bass playing brothers?
Pardon. The actual members of his family? You don't mean metaphorically, you mean literally.
Yes.
His family.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, okay.
Eddie Cole and Freddie Cole, yes. And Ike Cole.
Nat's father, by the time they were kids, was a preacher who had a Baptist church in the south side of Chicago, what they used to call Bronzeville. And they had the older brothers had been born in Montgomery, Alabama, and they came up as part of the Great Migration to feel the warmth of other sons, as we say, of other sons, S-O-N-S. But in Chicago, they happened to be right at ground zero at this huge, you know, as you know, this huge sort of outbreak of jazz and African-American music in Chicago. You know, this was, you know, the almost more than any other city, more than New Orleans, more than New York, even more than Kansas City, maybe at that point, Chicago was the center of the jazz world. And all of the Reverend's four sons went into music. And they all, well, I think Eddie was a bass player for most of his career. This is the older brother. He was 10 years older than Nat. When he was a young man, he began working with bands. And during the, sort of the first moment when African-American bands were playing outside of America, he got a gig with Noble Sissle, creator of Shuffle Along, great songwriter, entertainer. And Noble Sissle was leading a big band in the late 1920s that played all over Europe. And Eddie was with him for at least 4 or 5 years. He was Noble Sissle's, he played tuba and he played bass. He sang with the band. We even have an early video, a film of Eddie singing with the Noble Sissle Orchestra in London in 1931. And Nat was the second son, and the two younger sons were Ike, who worked in and out of music. There's an interesting video of him doing a tribute to Nat King Cole in the 60s. And of course, Freddie, who, sad to say, just left us a few months ago. Freddie was 89. Was he 88 or 89? I think he would have been 89, so he was 88. And Freddie was Nat's younger brother by 12 years, born in 1931. And Freddie grew up sort of in Nat's shadow, but he managed to have this remarkable career of his own. And was an outstanding pianist and singer who occasionally did some of his brother's songs and was undeniably Nat's younger brother, but had a great, I think he had a wonderful career, was a wonderful pianist and singer. And I would say you could enjoy Freddie's music. I don't think it's too radical to say, even if you had no idea who Nat King Cole was and never really listened to Nat Cole, you could still enjoy Freddie. He was a wonderful pianist and singer and a very dear friend, a wonderful, wonderful man. And I like to, one of the things I'm most proud of is I'm the first guy to write about Nat, certainly the first biographer that Freddie ever talked to. And he didn't do it all at once. He did it over, that's one of the advantages of the fact that I started this book so long ago. The fact that I was able to talk to Freddie in drips and drabs over a 25-year period. And that's the thing I'm proudest about. And the thing that I'm saddest about is that he literally died almost the month the book was published. I did not have a chance to send it to him. So I don't know what he thought. But yeah, Freddie was a wonderful, wonderful musician as well.
You know, that's, again, you know, one of the incredible things about Nat Cole is that, you know, he forms an intersection, you know, but just between so many people. I mean, you know, he played with Coleman Hawkins and Lester Young. We have him on a short little session there with Charlie Parker and so many other wonderful people. Two people who come together in the Nat Cole intersection are two people probably never mentioned in the same sentence, Joe Mooney and Nina Simone.
Yeah.
And let's deal with Joe Mooney first. Now, again, Joe Mooney is someone that most of our listeners probably have never heard of. But he, well, is it fair to say that his trio was one of the few ones that you can talk about in the same breath with Nat Cole's trio in terms of the ingenuity and innovation almost of the arrangements and how far they went harmonically and how clever?
Oh, I love the Joe Mooney trio. I wish there was, those recordings were easy to get. Yes.
Is there an intersection between two trios?
The fact that Joe Mooney has this group, was it a trio or a quartet? I'm trying to think. I think it was
a quartet. It was a quartet.
The whole vogue, in fact, Nat said that in an interview, even in the 50s, he said, one of the things I'm proudest about with the trio is that it really opened the door for these kind of, he didn't use the word, but to paraphrase, these kind of innovative small groups. And a lot of other people were starting to use that format. Famously, Paige Kavanaugh, Al Viola, who worked for Frank Sinatra later on, and was Paige Kavanaugh's guitarist, said, oh yeah, Paige was the White Nat Cole. You know, that's what we were trying to do. We were trying to be the white version of the King Cole trio. And Joe Mooney, certainly. And the fact that Joe Mooney got a gig on 52nd Street with this trio-like group, which happened to have four musicians, not that important, but was due to the fact that Nat King Cole had been there before him. And yes, definitely, the point of difference between them is Nat, especially Well, when he first started singing, his voice was, you know, his range was much more narrow. And Joe Mooney, like the younger Nat, shows what you can do vocally with a much smaller voice, a much smaller range. I once said about Joe, the way he phrased and the way he used that really sort of small, specific voice to put those songs over, if he had had a big voice, you know, if he had sounded like Tony Martin, it would have just gotten in the way. You know, he couldn't, those vocal resources would have just, you know, interfered with the way Joe Mooney puts over a song. He was a tremendous, he sang ballads great as well. He's best known for these kind of quirky, adorable novelty, what they used to call novelty songs. We could call them comedy songs or whatever. Things like A Man with $1 Million and his really adorable version of Tea for Two. Yeah, Joe Mooney was definitely, you know, took the idea of the King Cole Trio and you know, marched in the whole other direction. If John Pizzarelli were here, he would, you know, agree with that. I mean, he loved both the Joe Mooney and the King Cole.
Yeah. Sure.
And now, so Bucky played with Joe Mooney, right?
That's right.
Bucky was Joe's guitar.
Now, in between Joe Mooney and Nat Cole and Nina Simone, I just want to talk for a moment about Art Tatum. Because on certain of the small group records that Nat Cole made with Lester Young, which, you know, might really be the ultimate definition of him as a jazz pianist. You just take the two trio records with Lester Young and there you get, you know, a real picture where he plays even more creatively or in a different way than he does with the trio because there's no bass on him. But the point being that even Art Tatum, who was the god to every jazz pianist, there was one. Is it fair to say that his trio was in response to Nat Cole's example?
I think that when Nat was younger, Tatum was definitely one of, I mean, you know, not just when he was younger, but as a piano player, Tatum was one of his gods, maybe second only to Father Hines. And he loved Tatum. But even by 1940, and this is way before Capitol Records, I actually worked on a boxed set that Residence Records put out last year that documents all this. But even before Nat started to catch on with, you know, the international audience and the white audience and whatever, but even by 1940, the trio was so popular that even established musicians started formulating a response to it. And the guy that ran, what's his name? Phoebe Jacobs' father, Ralph Watkins. Ralph Watkins said that obviously Nat loved Art Tatum and was hugely influenced by him. But when Tatum heard Nat, he wanted some of that. He thought that this was a vehicle by which his piano playing, you know, could reach a larger audience and do some interesting things musically. And he said that Tatum was really, you know, really would have loved to hire Nat Seidman away. It was Wesley Prince at this point, and especially Oscar Moore. And in fact, Oscar Moore did do a session with Art Tatum right after the trio first showed up in New York. So yeah, I think the King Cole Trio definitely showed Tatum more things he could do with his sound, including, you know, more ways to translate that amazing virtuosity into, you know, kind of popularity, you know, kind of more mainstream approach. And I definitely think that, you know, Tatum's small groups were put together as a response to the King Cole Trio, the band with Tiny Grimes slightly later, you know. I do not think Tatum would have done that had not Nat Cole, you know, showed what could be done with that format, especially highlighting piano and guitar together.
We're still on the way to Nina Simone, who also played wonderful piano, but let's just stop there for one more moment. Lionel Hampton seems to have played quite a major role in the early days of Nat Cole, right? Because he used Nat Cole's band on a record date when Nat was kind of unknown. Do you know anything about their relationship?
Yes, when Nat first got to Los Angeles, of course, Lionel Hampton had been there, and Hampton had his own band before he went out with Benny, and Nat always said that Hamp was super helpful. He was one of the first musicians that he met when he came to Los Angeles. And Hamp was always, you know, looking, going around and trying to help him, you know, get established. And Nat was only like 17 at this point. And Hamp, when he was making those classic albums, which I think you did the notes for the box set, the classic albums, not album sessions, for RCA, and he used all these great musicians. Two sessions from the summer of 1940 featured the King Cole Trio as a, you know, in the middle of a Lionel Hampton ensemble. And those were they were really the first records that Nat made where you really hear the trio. And Hamp added to it with vibes and his own piano playing, but he basically let the whole sound of the trio come through. And those were hugely important. It was the first time people really heard the trio on a record that you could go out and buy. And I mean, Nat's previous recordings were much harder to hear and, you know, not readily available. So Ralph Watkins, in fact, said that when he heard those records, he went out and hired the trio based on hearing them, you know, on the Lionel Hampton records. So they were enormously important. And yeah, Hamp did a lot, as Nat, you know, acknowledged. He did a lot to help promote Nat and the trio and help, you know, Nat's career get off the ground. So yeah, Hampton was an enormous influence. I wish that in the 50s, say, they had done an album together for Norman Granz or something like that. That would have been really, really special, like what Hampton did with Tatum, which is a great album.
And now let's move to Nina Simone. And on the one hand, you know, whereas Nat was of a different generation and dealt with issues in his way, when you talked about either ironically or by deflecting or by understating just his own approach to dealing with race and things like that, in terms of the way he talked to the public, Nina Simone, of course, is on the one hand very similar to him in terms of her artistry, and on the other hand, you know, different generation than Mississippi Goddamn and all that. But another thing that they share was, frankly, and it's a sensitive topic, as are all these topics, is how dark complected they were. And that Nat Cole was one of the first major musicians to break through. I mean, we know from Louis Armstrong's example, when he said, when he was in Fletcher Henderson's band, that one of the reasons Henderson didn't feature him more up at the microphone was because he was too dark complected and he didn't want that look for his band. Nat Cole, similarly. And then we have the irony, of course, with Nina Simone, when they went to make her biopic, there was this great controversy that they picked somebody who was lighter complected.
And that, but yes, to a certain degree, Nat's skin color was an issue. In fact, Maria, Nat's wife, who was from the black bourgeoisie, she had previously sung with Duke Ellington, as you well know. Their daughter, Natalie, talked about that even in her book, that, yeah, there was this tremendous sort of intra-racism, which was judgment within the black community itself based on skin color. And that was another obstacle that Nat got around. In the 1950s, he was an incredibly handsome, good-looking man with this radiant dark skin, this kind of inner glow that came out of it. And yes, that would have been a roadblock for him, you know, in a period when, you know, lighter skinned entertainers were favored. And as you point out in the Nina Simone biography, perhaps that's true even to this day. It's another thing that Nina Simone had to contend with. And the whole model of being a singer pianist really comes from that, more than Fats Waller, more than Putney Dandridge, more than other people we know who were singer pianists, you know, from a previous era. The whole idea of being that big a star who plays piano and sings really is the Nat King Cole icon.
Will, this has been really, really great. And I want to thank you, you know, not only for appearing on the show here, for writing this wonderful book. You know, there have been previous books about Nat Cole, each of which, you know, the Epstein book, you know, has things from his wife that were new and which you folded into your, I would say, more rigorous and objective biography, plus all the music things. And I just want to mention in passing here, your wonderful books on greatest recordings, on greatest songs, and specifically one of my favorite of your books, which is your Frank Sinatra book, which I know of no Sinatra book like it, because you take us through his life through a real close focus on the music and the arrangers and the things that are really made Sinatra, Sinatra. So I just want to tell you in public, you know, I've done it before, again, how great your books are, and they'll always be on the bookshelves of people who love this stuff. If you had to pick, here's an impossible question. Can you give us your short list of favorite Nat Cole records, just for you, not for us, but that you tend to go back to time and time again?
You know, certain things by the trio, but actually I've probably played the 1942 Nat King Cole, Lester Young session more than anything. You know, just every note of those is so perfect. Every note that Lester plays, every note that Nat plays. Boy, wow. My all-time favorites, I mean, of course, I have some quirky favorites. I once asked Freddie Cole what his favorite Nat Cole song was. Believe it or not, he said Strange, which is not a hit, not even a song that's ever done in Nat King Cole tributes, but it's written for him by Martin Fisher. And I talk about Martin Fisher in the book. Martin Fisher was this really extraordinary songwriter who wrote some of the dopiest novelties for Nat, but also wrote these really complex and beautiful ballads. You know, he was like, if Louis Jordan and Billy Strayhorn were the same person, you know, that's who Marvin Fisher was. And when I was working in the Mosaic set, I actually got him on the phone. I can't really say I interviewed him because I didn't get him to talk to me for more than like 10 minutes. But Marvin Fisher wrote The Geek, you know, which is this stuff. It's a very interesting harmonic piece, but it's this dopey novelty where they just sing about the geek. But he also wrote Strange, and he wrote When Sunny Gets Blue, which is this incredibly, you know, sophisticated, harmonically and lyrically progressive ballad. You know, he wrote the most beautiful things. Strange is a great one, When Sunny Gets Blue. Of course, I love Stardust. A particular favorite of mine, I don't think anybody would name Lazy, Hazy, Crazy Days of Summer as their favorite Nat Cole record, but That Sunday, That Summer, which is a song on the album, is definitely in my top 10. Beautiful, beautiful song by the Sherman brothers, not Joel and Noel Sherman, not Robert and Richard Sherman, the other Sherman brothers, also wrote Rambling Rose. They wrote this beautiful ballad with George David Weiss called That Sunday, That Summer. And in fact, Betty Carter made a record of it later on. That's a sleeper of a beautiful ballad that's not always done. You know, the obvious ones, the songs that are done on all the Nat King Cole tributes. It's interesting that Nat only did Smile once. He just sang it in the studio, and he did it once on Ed Sullivan. He never seems to have sung it in concert. And yet after he died, people ascribed that song to him, and it became more important after he died because it became sort of a song about him. That, you know, he was smiling in the face of racism, smiling in the face of, you know, the adversity he had to overcome, and even had to, you know, and historically speaking, he's smiling in the face of having died of cancer at 45. You know, he still smiles at us in spite of all these horrible things, and it became much more important, I think, after he died. The same with Unforgettable. He sang that a few times while he was alive. It was a minor hit. It was not, you know, it was nowhere near as big as, say, Too Young. Nowhere near as big as Nature Boy or Mona Lisa. And yet, Unforgettable, after Nat died in 1965, it kind of became a song about him. It became, you know, autobiographical or reflective, you know, of his own thing. And that's the song that people, you know, those two songs, Smile and Unforgettable, kind of became about Nat. And people always include them in Nat King Cole tributes, even though he didn't really sing them all that much, interestingly enough. Well, that's another long answer to a short question.
It's wonderful. Will Friedwald, author of Straighten Up and Fly Right, the new Nat Cole biography. Thank you so much for joining us. You are a not infrequent guest at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem, sometimes doing your own programs and appearing as guests. And we hope to see you again soon.
Yes.
Thanks.
Thank you for all the good work you're doing, especially during this crazy time. Hey.
Thank you for joining us for this edition of Jazz for Curious Readers. The National Jazz Museum presents many programs, not all historical in nature, a lot of contemporary issues and artists as well. You can find out about us on our website, www.jmih.org, our Facebook page. We also have a YouTube channel. I'm Lauren Schoenberg, senior scholar at the museum, and on behalf of our staff, our board, our volunteers, and everyone in our family, we thank you for joining us today and hope that we'll see you again soon.
I've just found joy. I'm as happy as a baby boy with another brand new choo-choo joy. When I met my sweet Lorraine, 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 she's got a pair of eyes that are brighter than the summer skies. When you see them, you realize why I love my sweet Lorraine.